Complicated,
burdensome, stressful,
pressure,
impossible,
baffling, intangible,
alienating,
confusing,
clear.
The profound things that Jesus taught are at their core clear and simple.
Centered around three key relationships.
Up, in, and out.
Up, a relationship with God.
Grow it. Give it time and attention.
Give Him time and attention.
Because He first loved us.
He is worth it.
He is first.
In. It's us.
You, me, all of us.
Together.
Not the programs.
Not the building.
Not the schedule.
We, all of us, are the church.
And they will know us by our love.
Our love for one another.
So get your hands dirty.
Serve.
Challenge.
Build up.
Go deep.
Go deeper.
Together.
Live in community.
So they will know us by our love.
Out. Look around you.
The mission is here.
And here.
And here.
So go. Wherever there's brokenness.
Uncertainty.
Despair.
Indifference.
Wherever people don't know the love of Jesus.
With God, we can be restorers.
Offering faith,
hope, and love.
This is our mission, to go.
So go.
Up.
In.
Out.
God.
Community.
Mission.
Align your focus around these three relationships.
And grow.
Grow as a follower of Christ.
Grow with us.
Here you'll see that nobody's perfect.
Everyone's welcome.
And anything is possible.
Good morning. I just realized what happened. I'm gone one Sunday and the platform is gone to make me 5'8". So I'm back to 5 feet tall. So I'll put it back while we sing a song next. Welcome everyone to the United Methodist Church of Thousand Oaks. What a joy it is to see each and every one of us and be able to know that we are here to connect outward with God, grow deeper within our souls, and to be with one another, not only here in this beautiful sanctuary, but to know that there are people out there that we are to go out, up, in, and out. So I hope you remember those three words as we realize that we are to meet in community with God, with one another, and with the Spirit within us. So today is the first Sunday where we will be starting a stewardship campaign, a stewardship drive with the theme of From Thanksgiving to Gratitude. So you don't have to Google about what the differences are between Thanksgiving and gratitude. We will go into that through the next four Sundays, and I am really excited to know that we will also have guest speakers. Well, they're not guests, they're members of our church who will be sharing their feeling about giving and what it means for them to give and their stewardship and their call to be in sharing their resources. Also, today is Reformation Sunday, so the first song that we will be singing will be A Mighty Fortress Is Our God, the old-time hymn from Martin Luther, who is one of the many theologians, pastors, and teachers who began the Reformation of the Christian church itself. I think I've spoke enough, so we will be into a worshipful mode as we begin our song. Thank you. That's important. That's important. Okay, let us pray together. Oh, gracious and loving God, what a joy it is to know, God, that you formed us in the image of the very God who created us, so that we can be in communion with you as we are with the Holy Spirit that you sent us, who constantly guides us and reminds us and leads us to your love and grace, and that we are created to encourage one another, to pray for one another, and to know that it is by our love that we are known to the world. We thank you for all the guests who are here, for their precious presence. Their presence is precious to us. For the old-timers who are here, for you care for each and every one of us. And we thank you, God, that you gave us your Son, Jesus the Christ, from whom we find salvation. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Good morning. Please rise if you're able to sing A Mighty Fortress Is Our God.
Thank you.
as the children make their way to the front for a time of God's moment of for the children. Come on down, kids. And also for those who are worshiping with us online, I'm trying to see which camera it is. Those that are worshiping online, please have the children come and join us in this special moment set apart for all of us, but especially for the little ones. Good morning, children. How are you today?
Good.
Good? Okay. I am doing great, and it's so good to see you here at church, because I'm going to tell you a little story about, it's a big story actually, from a little guy. it's a story about a man named Zacchaeus. Have you ever named that name? Yeah, do you know this song? Yes? Okay, yes. And so what I thought we would do is to, I know that we have people here that may know this song, so we are going to ask them to sing along with us, because I think it's a cute song. And not only, so instead of telling the story, since we have this song, why don't we sing it? Yeah? All right. So, and all of you who are familiar with it, please sing along. And I'm going to play it from my phone, but we can all sing it together. Okay? Ready? Can you hear it? No? Hang on one second. Barely hear it, right? Okay.
Zacchaeus was a wee little man, and wee little man was he. He climbed up on a sycamore tree for the Lord he wanted to.
Let's sing it all along.
And when the Savior passed that way, he looked up in the tree. And he said,
Zacchaeus, you come down.
For I'm going to your house today.
For I'm going to your house today.
Zacchaeus
was a wee little man. A wee little man was he.
He climbed up in a
sycamore tree. And
the Lord he wanted to see. And when the Savior passed that way, he looked up in the tree. And he said,
Zacchaeus, you come down.
For I'm going to your house today.
For I'm going to your house today.
Zacchaeus
was a wee little man, a happy man was he.
For he had seen the Lord that day, and a happy
man was he.
And a very happy man was he.
All right, okay, so that's about the two verses that we have. Thank you, kids, for singing along. Thank you. So we heard about Zacchaeus was a wee little man. And what did he do to go see Jesus? Did you hear the song? What did he do to go see Jesus, okay? What did he do? He climbed in a sycamore tree. So I thought of that for a long time because, you know, back then, men wore long robes, very similar to the one I'm wearing. And in that time, men were not supposed to show their ankles. That was not a gentleman thing to do, okay? They were not supposed to show their ankles. So they always had those long robes, and they were not to, if you are of a high class, you're not supposed to run. You're not supposed, because if you run, you gotta like, it's kind of hard to run with a long robe, right? So you gotta lift your robe, and then you gotta run, and ooh, people are gonna go, ooh, look at that, right? So for Zacchaeus, if he was a chief tax collector, that meant that he was not liked by the people because he stole money from them. But at the same time, it was a weird kind of situation because he had lots of money, so he had that kind of prestige with his, that kind of hierarchy, okay? People would like it, would see him as somebody with money. So he wore long robes. So what do you have to do to climb a tree? You kind of have to lift your robe up, right? It's kind of hard to climb with shoes and, you know, sandals especially, and a long robe. Huh? You've done it before? Wow. So you know how hard it is, right? Yeah. So what my point is going to be is that for Zacchaeus to go out of his way, to lift his robe, show his ankles, climb a tree, and even if it was a short branch, this guy is short, right? I will never try to climb a tree because I'll never be able to do it, okay? But so this man had to go through a lot to get to see Jesus. He worked at it by climbing the tree and balancing himself, making sure that he doesn't fall, showing the ankles, which is a no back then. But he tried to do the best to see Jesus. So what happened when Jesus saw him? Go ahead. He said, Zacchaeus, you come down, for I am going to your house today. He invited himself to his house, and everybody was shocked. So my point today is we got to be like Zacchaeus. We got to try everything that we can to see Jesus. He climbed up on the tree. We have to find ways where we can spend time with Jesus, even though it's hard sometimes, because I know you're all very busy. You guys are so busy with soccer and school and lessons and all the other things that you have to do. But we have to try the hardest to spend time with Jesus. Any idea how you can do that? Spend time with Jesus? Yes? You can pray. Yes. We all say amen. See, we can pray. What else can we do to spend time with Jesus? Go to church, and we are a church. Amen? Amen. All right. We get an amen on that. What else can we do to see Jesus and spend time with Jesus? Any of you over there? Any idea? I'll give you a hint. Bible. We can read the, right. We can read the Bible. Thank you. And then when I picked up my mom yesterday. We went out for dinner yesterday, and she sat in the back, and she's 91 actually, 91, and she started singing. She was off tune. She was flat. You guys wouldn't want her singing in the choir. But she just sang her heart out, the hymn. All the hymns that she remembers, she sang her heart out. So that's something that you can do. It wasn't very nice to hear, but it was touching, okay? So we say amen to that? Amen. Amen. So I know it's hard. Some of us are not singers, and it's hard to sing. But as Zacchaeus tried his darnest to go and see Jesus, we do all that we can to pray, to read the Bible, to sing our hymns, and to come to church. Okay, so let's pray. Gracious and loving God, we thank you for Zacchaeus. And though he was a wee little man, he became a changed man with the biggest heart. And he did that. He was able to be changed because he tried the best that he could to see Jesus. So help us, God, to do the best that we can to see Jesus every day. And help us to grow in you. In Jesus' name we pray, and we all say, amen. Amen. Okay. So Barbara, Miss Barbara in the back is ready to take your children to Sunday school. All right. I'll see you later. She's in the back. Okay. There you go. Now, let us share the love of God with one another, and please do look around, because we have very special guests among us, so get to know them and say hello. Oh, thank you.
Sing it, our prayer of confession. God of promised vision, we await your word of hope. As we stand at our watchposts, come to us in our need, for we are weary and heavy laden. As we await your reply to our pleas for mercy, respond to our longing for friendship. For we are beaten down by hatred and violence. Zeal for your endless love consumes us, even as we wait the promise of our salvation. Come to our homes this day and abide in our hearts each hour through the glory of your Son. Amen. And now hear these words of assurance. When all hope seems lost, Christ came to save the weak and the outcast. When justice lagged and rightlessness ebbed, Christ came to save the hopeless and despondent. Today, salvation has come to this house of worship, for in Christ we are renewed and made whole through the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
So for those who don't know me, I'm Jerry Hong, and my wife Candace is over there. And we're gonna show a short video. It's 2 minutes. It's called Giving Inspiration. And then Candace will speak. And then she's really good. And then you get to hear me, which, yeah, breaks the game. Now what can I say? But go ahead.
Jerry spends a lot of time looking at those videos, so I think this one really spoke to us. Pastor Anna asked Jerry and I to speak about our annual giving to the church. This request made me stop and think, because I haven't thought about it much, as it's rather automatic. It's just what we've done for many years. Jerry and I started coming to this church nearly 23 years ago. At the time, I think we were both looking for a sense of community that we probably didn't have anymore since our kids were grown and in college, and our contact with sports teams and friends had changed. I would imagine many of you, besides looking for a spiritual connection coming to church, were also looking for a sense of community. While finding a robust list of ministries this church was shepherding. And I believe we found what we were looking for, the sense of community that makes us want to contribute to our church so that it can continue for many more years. When the pandemic took over our lives nearly 3 years ago, many things obviously changed here. People have moved away, people have passed away. The pandemic brought a lot of financial challenges. As a church, some of it has been weathered with help from the federal government, with the payroll protection programs, and helps from saints of our church who have passed away. Larry Civitelli will talk more about this next week. Clearly, changes in our membership have brought financial challenges to our church. Now it's time to be thinking and praying about what we will give as individuals to sustain our church. Given all this, the fact is our church continues to give back so much to our community between the food programs, Westminster Clinic, study buddies, and hosting the temple here when they need the extra space. We continue to be the center of our community, and we do reach out to our community. Our gifts, tithes, offerings, and gifts of service help sustain our church and keep the campus running. Our ministry's running, and we are doing what Jesus would do, helping the least of these. The quote that was on the video by Winston Churchill, that we make our living by what we get, we make a life by what we give, speaks to both of us. We all make many lives better by giving to this church and supporting its ministries.
So there's the quote on the screen from Winston Churchill. We make a living by what we get. We make a life by what we give. And when I think about giving, I think of giving as gifts, as time, as money. And during a stewardship campaign, which I've heard quite a number of times at this church, it's always the same thing. You hear the questions. What is a tithe? How much should I give? Should I increase my tithe by 1%? But really, it's all about giving as you are able, when you think about it. How able are you to give? But I want to talk about what we receive in return for our giving. Do you believe it's in our nature? Now, in current terms, somebody would say DNA, or are we hardwired to give? And I think all you have to do is ask a child. Because if you ask a child to give, have you ever noticed the joy they give when they give, the smile on their face? It's almost like the joy they have is greater than the joy than when they receive a gift, because they can remember giving that gift, whether it's their time or money. But the gifts oftentimes go by the wayside pretty quickly. So how many times have you heard it is better to give than receive? You must have heard it when you were growing up as a child. I know I did. But you know what? When I thought about that phrase, I thought, is that actually in the Bible? It is. It really is. It's in Acts. It's in Acts, chapter 20, verse 35. But it's worded a little differently. It's worded, it is more blessed to give than to receive. Not it is better, but it is more blessed to give to receive. That to me means we get blessings back when we give. And you know, there have been numerous studies that have been shown that people that are givers, they're healthier, they're happier, they're less stressed, they suffer less anxiety, and actually, some studies indicate they have a longer life expectancy, which is kind of interesting to me. So if you're a Christian, one of the benefits, well, one of the things that we think about as a Christian is giving reflects God's character. We are like God. Giving is actually commanded in the Bible, depending on how you want to read the Bible. Giving expresses your trust in God, and giving advances the kingdom of God. Now, many of you have been here for baptisms or when new members have joined, and there's always a phrase, they go through that liturgy, you know, you open the book and they go, okay, read, da-da-da-da, follow along with me. And then it goes, we renew, and then that is we, everybody that's sitting out here, right? We renew our covenant to faithfully participate in the ministries of this church by our prayers, our presence, you're here, yes, okay, our gifts, and our service. And I think that's all, those four things really are about giving. Sometimes I think that when I look out on the congregation, I'm sitting back there in the sound booth, and I count the number of people in the service, and in some respects, it's very disappointing. It's disappointing because each of us has made a covenant, our presence. So when we're not here, okay, that may mean that your presence could have made a difference in somebody else's life. You may not have had to say anything. It may have been just you're sitting there. You might have smiled. And that may make a big difference for other people. So I'm going to end by saying this. In the book, The Seven Habits of Highly Effective People, the second habit is, do any of you recall reading that book? Begin with the end in mind. You know that when people are close to death, they don't want to be remembered for the money they made, for the big accomplishments or the awards that they received. What they want to be remembered for is who they were as a person. And I see some of you nodding because you know that's a truth. It is a truth. We want to be remembered for who you are. So that's what I have to say about stewardship. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Amen. Amen. We turn to the gospel reading of according to Luke, and if you choose to read from follow from the Pew Bible, it would be on page 82 of the New Testament. And then you can also follow through the app, UMCTO app, and there is a Bible section at the very bottom, which I choose to do because I can read better from the screen. So Luke 19, verses 1 through 10. It reads, "He entered Jericho and was passing through it. A man was there named Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and was rich. He was trying to see Jesus, who Jesus was. But on account of the crowd, he could not because he was short in stature. So he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore tree to see him because he was going to pass that way. When Jesus came to the place, he looked up and said, 'Zacchaeus, hurry and come down, for I must stay at your house today.' So he hurried down and was happy to welcome him. And all who saw it began to grumble and said, 'He has gone to be the guest of one who is a sinner.' Zacchaeus stood there and said to the Lord, 'Look, half of my possessions, Lord, I give to the poor. And if I have defrauded anyone of anything, I will pay back four times as much.' Then Jesus said to him, 'Today, salvation has come to this house because he too is the son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek out and to save the lost.'" Please pray with me. O God of salvation, you sent your Son, Jesus the Savior, to be in our midst to show us the way to life everlasting here on earth and eternally. Open our eyes, our hearts, and our minds, and may the meditation of our hearts be acceptable to you, and may the words of my mouth glorify your holy name. Amen. Today, as I mentioned to you, we do start our stewardship campaign with our focus on from Thanksgiving to gratitude. This is a quote that I found from the United Methodist Church CalPAC, umc.org website. And it is a quote from Henry Frederick Amy, who wrote, and I'm going to ask for the, there it goes, let's read the theme that we will be covering for the next four Sundays. Let's read it together, please. "Thankfulness is the beginning of gratitude. Gratitude is the completion of thankfulness. Thankfulness may consist merely of words. Gratitude is shown in acts." With this quote, we will be exploring how we can grow in our stewardship faithfulness by moving merely from saying the words, "thank you," right, to actual acts and doings of gratitude. In other words, we will be looking into how, out of thankfulness for all that God is and all that God does, how we are called to show our gratitude through acts of giving. I'm so grateful to Candace and Jerry Hong for sharing their testimony of the place stewardship has in their lives as children of God. Thank you. I thought long and hard to find an illustration to begin this sermon, and all of a sudden, I realized that I was not using my time wisely while searching on the web and other books. We heard a personal story powerfully that I hope and pray will augment this sermon. In the coming weeks, we will have other members of our faith family sharing their testimonies of stewardship. They gave it away for who it is next Sunday. It's Larry, which is totally fine. But if you want to know who are speaking the next few Sundays, you got to be here, part of being present in the house of the Lord. For this Sunday, we have a testimony from a man named Zacchaeus from the Bible. Some of you may be familiar with the wee little man, Zacchaeus, who climbed up a sycamore tree, for he wanted to see Jesus. Most people, most Bible interpreters and people believe that he climbed on the tree because he was too short. Sure, that would make sense. Get on something high if you're too short. Plus, there was the crowd. Yet, there was another reason he had to climb a tree. Zacchaeus probably couldn't get to Jesus even if he pushed and shoved with all his might. There was a big crowd surrounding Jesus, and that crowd did not like Zacchaeus. If he tried to push himself to the front of the crowd, they would push him back. He was not accepted. If he tried to shove his way through the crowd, they will push him away, out of the circle. If he tried to crawl, remember he was small, to see Jesus, the crowd will stomp on him. That's probably the reason he had to climb a tree. He was not part of the community. He was not accepted from the folks that were surrounding Jesus. Why was he not liked? He was actually hated. I know it is a harsh word, but Zacchaeus as a chief tax collector was considered detestable. Jesus was going through Jericho, which is a bustling hub for all commerce, and as such, Zacchaeus as a chief tax collector had a bountiful business collecting most of the overcharged taxes from tax collectors. For unknown reasons, Zacchaeus really wanted to see Jesus. I thought about what it was that would have drawn a successful man to want to climb a tree, to undignify himself, to see a poor man on his way to Jerusalem, where he has been telling people that he was going to Jerusalem to die on the cross. And I wonder if the disparity between Zacchaeus, whose presence would have caused people to hide away, and Jesus, who everyone seems to be drawn to, is exactly what got him to climb the tree. Zacchaeus was avoided. Jesus was sought out. Why? Who is this Jesus? So he climbed up to get a better look. And as the song goes, and when the Savior passed that way, he looked up on the tree and said, Zacchaeus, you come down, for I'm going to your house today. I love this part of the story. Have you noticed that that is the part where people pause and they say, Zacchaeus, you come down, for I'm going to your house today. And even as a child, I used to sing it with so much gusto. You know, it's just so exciting. Jesus is going to your house today. I love this story. And not because I have the affinity with Zacchaeus of being short. That's not it. I love this story because as curious Zacchaeus sought out Jesus from afar, Jesus sought Zacchaeus out with intentionality and came close to him. He invited himself to the house of a sinner for which the crowd grumbled. Imagine of all the hard and honest working people around, Jesus wants to go to the house of a thief. But to Jesus, Zacchaeus was another lost soul who needed to know the love of God in Jesus Christ. Zacchaeus may have been known by many as a deplorable man, but for Jesus, Zacchaeus, whom he calls by name, by the way, when nobody else will say the name Zacchaeus, Jesus calls him by his name. Hurry and come down, for Zacchaeus, I'm going to your house today. I love this story because it is one of the stories in which Jesus invites himself into the house and the heart of a sinner. Even if he is one of the worst kind of sinners, as the Israelites thought he was, at least in the eye of the people. But for Jesus, he was Zacchaeus who deserved to know the grace of God. As Zacchaeus sought Jesus, Jesus equally sought Zacchaeus. There's a song written by an anonymous person who many composers found it so appealing that they have it in different tunes. But the words speak clearly to this encounter between Jesus and Zacchaeus. And it reads the following. It is in the Old English, and I thought of changing it, but that would be changing the original, so I'm going to keep it as is. It says, I sought the Lord, and afterward I knew. He moved my soul to seek him, seeking me. It was not that I found, O Savior, true. No, I was found of thee. Thou didst reach forth thy hand and mind and fold. I walked and sank not on the storm-vexed sea. It was not so much that I on thee took hold as thou, dear Lord, on me. I find, I walk, I love, but oh, the whole of love is but by answer, Lord of thee. For thou were long beforehand with my soul, always thou loved me. This unknown reason for which Zacchaeus was driven to climb up the tree turned out to be a divinely appointed encounter, for as Jesus said, today I must come to your house. It was meant to be. And unlike the rich young man whom the previous chapter we find could not fathom giving away all the riches that hindered him from coming into relationship with Jesus, Zacchaeus is thrilled to welcome God. The rich young man walked away, for he was saddened that he could not choose Jesus. Zacchaeus, on the other hand, is thrilled that Jesus is coming to his home and his heart. He's a changed man. He gives half of his possessions to the poor, and those whom he defrauded, he gives back four times as much. To this transformed man, Jesus says to him, today salvation has come into your house, because he's too a son of Abraham, for the Son of Man came to seek out and to save the lost. This is an example of someone who goes from thanksgiving to acts of gratitude. This is an example of someone who gives, Zacchaeus. Thanksgiving is found in Jesus, who sought him out, and because of that, he becomes his personal savior. And gratitude comes in response to God's grace and love, as he shows in acts of sharing with the poor and in returning the monies that he has stolen from the people. Again, as Henry Amy wrote, thankfulness is the beginning of gratitude. Gratitude is the completion of thankfulness. Thankfulness may consist merely of words. Gratitude is shown in acts. So today, through the story of Zacchaeus, we give thanks for salvation that we find through Jesus, the Savior, who sought Zacchaeus and seeks us, all of us, as well. My personal story of salvation came when I figured out that God had been and has been loving me for before I knew God's gift of salvation. As some of you know, I grew up in a Christian home. My father was a pastor, and my mother worked as a lay pastor, lay preacher. We never had any trouble finding someone to pray, preach, baptize, or perform weddings and funerals. We had plenty. I think we could have formed our own annual conference. But at some point in my life, in my 20s, I realized that just because I grew up with so many Christian pastors did not make me a Christian. Just because I was baptized did not make me a Christian. Just because I was confirmed did not really make me a Christian. Until one day, I took a Bible study on John Wesley's teaching of prevenient grace. Some of you may have heard that word, those terminologies. This is a divine guidance of God's grace that precedes our own awareness of God's love. In other words, God's love exists in us from the very beginning and reveals itself to us even before we are aware of that love. That is the meaning of prevenient grace, the love that comes to us even before we are aware of that love. I know that you're all reading the Book of Discipline, but we'll get to it in a minute. Wesleyan theology teaches that God initiates salvation through prevenient grace while we still maintain our God-given free will. Free will, remember, Zacchaeus chose Jesus. The rich young man did not. God still gives us free will to choose. The United Methodist Church, the United Methodist Book of Discipline from the 2004 says, defines prevenient grace as, quote, the divine love that surrounds all humanity and precedes any and all of our conscious impulses. This grace prompts our first wish to please God, our first glimmer of understanding concerning God's will, and our first slight transient conviction of having sinned against God. God's grace also awakens in us an earnest longing for deliverance from sin and death, and moves us toward repentance and faith. That's prevenient grace. I believe that anonymous writer of the song captures Zacchaeus' experiences. I sought the Lord, and afterward, we can put that up there. I sought the Lord, and afterward I knew He moved my soul to seek Him, seeking me. It was not I that found, O Savior, true. No, I was found of Thee. God's prevenient grace is what led me to become a Christian in the Methodist faith and eventually a pastor in the United Methodist Church. For now, I can see that God had been with me, leading me to know His grace from the very beginning, even when I wasn't aware of that leading guidance. Looking back, I see how God had been pulling me to Him all of my life. In my early 20s, I did my best to run away from God and be absent in the church. He was always there, though, no matter how far I ran away from God and church. God had always been leading me back to Him, never letting me go too far. When I think of God's seeking me and keeping me. I see the imagery of a bungee cord tied around my waist. I will never jump, trust me. But I felt that bungee cord around me. You know, I'll run away from God and church, and I'll go as far as I can, and I'll try to go further, and oh, I just felt that tugging me back to God. You know, now that I look back, I realize that it was not a bungee cord. And the elastic aspect of it that kept me coming back to God. Now that I look back and see, and even today, what I see more clearly, the bungee cord is actually an umbilical cord. It's my umbilical cord to God, the source of spiritual life and eternal life. As beloved children of God, we are continuously sought out by God. Whether you are aware or not, God in Jesus comes to you wherever you are in your life. Up in a sycamore tree or in a pew at the United Methodist Church of Thousand Oaks. And he calls your name, as he did Zacchaeus. And he invites himself into our lives every day. And we are freely given the gift of salvation. And our movement from thanksgiving to gratitude is to put it into action. As Zacchaeus shared it with the poor people. All that he had, half of what he had, and even made up four times the difference to those whom he defrauded. Today, here and now, our act of gratitude is to help the church to be the messenger of God's gift of salvation to all. We have been given that gift of salvation, we are to share it with others. Some of you may have already received a letter with a pledge card in the envelope. This is a pledge card for you to hold and pray. As you consider the sharing messages from the homes, from the way God speaks to you today as he calls your name and says, "Get down. I'm going to your house today. I want you to know me, and I want me to know you, and I want to give this gift of salvation, which is freely given to you. All you got to do is take it. I'm not going to make it. I'm not going to make you take it. It's your will that counts. And your movement from gratitude to from thanksgiving to gratitude. Prayerfully consider how you can be in partnership with the church that Christ found so that others may find the gift of salvation as well. Either send the completed pledge card to the office, you can mail it, you can email it, the information is all there for you to know where to send it to, or if you prefer, you can bring it on November the 20th, the Sunday right before Thanksgiving, when we will have a time of consecrating all of our offerings to the Lord. And to highlight the consecration, we will have a potluck, a Thanksgiving potluck. How wonderful is that? We're Methodists. We all like potlucks, right? Oh, I'm not sure. Do we like potlucks? Yes? Okay, so bring your stewardship cards. Let's consecrate it. And even before we get to the potluck, we give thanks to God for giving us this opportunity that we can be a church. And then we will have the potluck. Friends, may the God who calls Zacchaeus and knows to call us by our names continue to remind us that we were loved, we are loved, and we will be loved. For Jesus came exactly for that reason, to help us to love God up, grow in the love of God as we learn to serve in, as we serve others out. May that love that God has given us give us the source and the inspiration and the hope that we can find in the trust as we move from thanksgiving to gratitude. Amen.
Let's stand and sing, "Take My Life and Let It Be."
Make it easy to give here at UMCTO. There are baskets at the front if you would like to bring it forward. If you like to do it online, we have an app for that. Also, you can go on our website and you can donate through PayPal. And you can set it up so that you can do online banking through online banking. And for your prayers, we have a basket up here, and we also have the same app. And you can ask for prayer on the app, or you can email at prayer@umcto.org, and Pastor Anna will get it, and she will pray for you. And join us, please, in Amazing Grace. My chains are gone.
Thank you. peace of
the hour of first
believe.
Sing it out.
My chains are gone. I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy brings unending love, amazing grace.
The
will you join with me in our prayer of thanksgiving? Let us pray. God of many blessings, you come to us as Christ came to Zacchaeus, that salvation may come to our homes to show us the power of your love. when we stand at the watchposts of our lives. You meet us to share a vision of hope and justice. May the offering we bring before you now be a sign of our commitment to live your vision and to share your generosity with our world. Come to us, abide in our homes, and work within these offerings that all may know your love and justice. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
So Kaneo Connects continues on Wednesdays in November at St. Matthew's UMC, and that's the one in Newbury Park. And that is from 5:30 to 7:15, and it is a great time to connect. We need you. We need you. I'm looking at all of you for Sunday school. All you really need is to love God. That will shine through to our children, and we would appreciate any help that you can give in that. And you can see Amy if you would like to help out in Sunday school. Thank you. And last but not least, we also need you for our study buddy program. We're looking for volunteers to read and to help out with the children from Glenwood Elementary School. It is a wonderful opportunity. So thank you for your consideration. And now we're going to sing some more.
Yeah, let's do it.
If
you could stand if you are able, please. We're going to close out the songs with This Is Amazing Grace.
This is Amazing Grace.
Who breaks the powers of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings.
Yeah.
This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh. You've done for me. Who brings the chaos back to order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who leads a nation with truth and justice, to shine the sun in all its brilliance, the King of glory, the King of all kings. Yeah, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear the grace.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquers the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquers the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love that you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Yeah. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
And I'm going to check the emails, and you, as Liz mentioned, you are able to email me through prayer@umcto.org. And okay, so I do have a few prayer requests from Jonathan, whose cousin Sandy in Indiana has a severe ear infection. So please pray for Sandy. And then a prayer request from Sarah, who's the daughter of a friend. Heather has non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, and also for Heather's parents, siblings, and friends. Please continue to be in prayer for that awful. It occurred to me that as I was reading about the crowd surrounding Jesus, how another crowd in Korea turned out to be so tragic. 151 dead and 82 injured. About 90% were identified, 10% were under 17, so they could not be identified because they're not required to carry IDs. And some foreigners as well. There were people from America, Iran, Norway, China, Uzbekistan, Thai, and so many people from all around the world. Itaewon is like the spot to go if you're going to gather together and have a party. So I can just imagine how crazy it must have been after 3 years of COVID. Please continue. And also, I just read that India had a bridge collapse and 60 people are killed, many of them children. So please keep these awful tragedies that's happening around the world. And in the same, also please pray for our stewardship campaign for the future speakers and for God to move us and stir us and help us for UMCTO to continue to be such a lighthouse in the community as well as in the world, because we are doing so much for others as we are helping each other to grow inwards, to love God and others. Let's pray. Oh, gracious and loving God, we take a deep breath because we are burdened. So burdened with the cries of parents and friends and siblings of those who are mourning the injured and those who passed away. Most of the deceased being young people in their 20s. The young children who are not able to be identified yet. God, we also lift up to you the most recent incident in India, where 60 people from a collapsed bridge had perished, many of them being children. God, we sit in this beautiful sanctuary in our comfortable pews, yet our hearts are broken for these people. So we pray, God, that words of comfort that we cannot utter may be spoken by the Holy Spirit to those that are going through such difficult times. May you give the leadership the ability to do all that they can to provide comfort, information, and guidance to these families that are lost. May your comfort brought to them by friends and family give them the peace that passes all human understanding, for it's only in you, God, that we can find that comfort. Please, God, be with them. Be with Sandy as she deals with her ear infection. I think most of us know how painful those can be. So, God, we pray for healing, for comfort, and for that pain to go away as Sandy relies on you, the ultimate physician. May you be with the family of Heather as she has non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, that you will give the doctors the ability to come to a place of treatment that is best for her, that you will comfort them and give them peace as well. We thank you, God, again for salvation that we find in the name of Jesus the Christ, who is the Savior, and for that salvation to be shared with others, God, for we want the peace of God that passes all understanding and the joy and the love that we find in the grace of Christ to be something for us to share with everyone. Thank you, and in Jesus' name we pray. As we together pray, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us for our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Following Jesus is very clear. We go up to grow in God. We go in to grow in the Spirit. And we go out to share the grace of love, grace and love of God with everyone. Be clear. Amen. Thank you.